Well, good morning. It's my real joy to welcome you here today for the Dean's Grand Rounds on the Future of Public Health. For those of you who I haven't met, I'm Linda Fried, and I have the honor of serving as the Dean here at the Mailman School. For those of you who are new to our school, the Dean's Grand Rounds is our school's approximately monthly intellectual convening across the whole school, across departments and centers, across disciplines, to really tackle issues that are relevant to all of us as professionals and emerging professionals in the field of public health. What are the issues of our future? What do we need to know about the issues that perhaps we don't work on every day, but actually would affect our thinking about what we do work on? What are the things we have to solve together? What are the ways we need to each play our part in pushing forward a better future? All of these are part of the thinking and the goals of the Dean's Grand Rounds on the Future of Public Health. The theme this year, building on last year's theme of public health as a public good, this year's theme is dedicated to sequentially tackling the big questions that have to be solved to position public health for more impactful and effective leadership. Asking across all of the grand rounds this year, what would it take? And today's conversations asks, what would it take to transform our health systems and create health equity? To accomplish our school's mission to build a healthy and just world, we have to work collaboratively to get our science, of course, used to better the opportunity for health and health equity for everyone. We have to work collaboratively with local, national, and global organizations to translate knowledge and to align and collaborate on strategies. We know, of course, that in the United States, the field of public health, and particularly our public health system, which leads the actions we must take collectively to accomplish the health of the public, our public health system faces financial, bureaucratic, and political obstacles that not infrequently interfere with the ability to meet mission. Further, there are so many changes underway. Our knowledge of prevention in the last few decades has really exploded and lays the basis actually for amplifying the potential to deliver health to populations. And in addition, the issues that confront us have expanded, the challenges we're confronted with, and they in fact solved, and we need to recognize that those changes actually impact the effectiveness of solutions for pre-existing challenges. So this is getting pretty complicated and pretty urgent and important to have a shared vision and a pathway for solutions. So I can't think of two better people to lead our discussion today. Before I introduce them, I'd like to invite the people standing in the back to come sit down. Welcome. So, Dr. Michael McGinnis just introduced himself. And I'm pleased to add to his introduction. Dr. McGinnis is the Leonard D. Schaeffer Executive Officer and Senior Scholar and Executive Director of the National Academy of Medicine's Leadership Consortium for a Learning Health System. For those of you who don't know the U.S. National Academy of Medicine, it is the U.S.'s leading organization to provide guidance to the nation and increasingly to the world on how to create a future of better health. Dr. McGinnis himself has had continuous appointments at the Department of Health and Human Services, prior to being at the National Academy of Medicine, continuous appointments through the Carter, Reagan, Bush, and Clinton administrations at the Department of Health and Human Services with policy responsibilities for disease prevention and health promotion. In this capacity, he was founder and steward of still ongoing programs and policies, including the Healthy People Program of National Goals and Objectives, the HHS-USDA Dietary Guidelines for Americans, the U.S. Preventive Services Task Force, and the 10 Services of Public Health. Dr. McGinnis is perhaps most recognized for his leadership and his research and publications on population health and the root causes of morbidity and mortality and of health equity, as well as its solutions. Welcome, Mike. Very happy to have you here. And before I turn you over to the podium here, or the podium over to you, I'll say that our second speaker today, it will be our very own Dr. Michael Sparer, the professor and chair of the Department of Health Policy and Management here at Columbia's Mailman School of Public Health. We have two Michaels, so I'm going to use their last names. It's not the only reason why you were invited to speak together. But Dr. Sparer is a national leader, of course, on the politics of healthcare, with a particular emphasis on health insurance and health delivery systems for low and middle income populations, and also on the politics of public health. His expanding focus is on the public health system itself, and he will soon be launching a very exciting and important new center on public health systems. I am going to turn this over to our guest and Mike One.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Linda, and I'll stay close to Mike Three here so that you can hear me as well as possible. I'm going to turn on my alarm because I tend to wander. I don't want to wander too far into your lunch hour or beyond it. So there we go. Thank you. Thank you for all you do for the National Academy of Medicine. Let me start there. We're giving careful consideration to doubling her salary as an NAM volunteer, because she doesn't get any money from the NAM, but she certainly provides service that's extraordinary to us and to the field, and obviously for her leadership here in the school and to the field beyond. You started off with the word joy, and it's really a joy for me to be here, not only with you, but to see many representatives of the future workforce for public health. It's really encouraging at a time in which we kind of wonder where we're going to get the kind of creative people to meet the extraordinary need, as Michael One will talk about a little bit later. The aim of recent investments was to increase the workforce in public health by 100,000, but it's only through your leadership and vision and commitment by example that we'll be able to reach that kind of goal. So thanks to each of you. The future of public health is a very broad topic, obviously, broader than even you might think when we consider the extent to which the tentacles of public health are essentially extended throughout the entire health system, in healthcare, in biomedical research, and fundamental to the leadership for society. Because it's so broad, I'm going to start with a few basic level setting questions, which should be easy for this crowd to answer. And if you don't answer or volunteer to answer, I'm going to call on you. So please don't be shy in that respect. And I'm going to start off. I mean, these are easy questions. They're second nature to all of you folks. So question number one, To show you how easy it is what's the what disease is the leading killer in the U.S.? Oh, come on. All right, this nice lady with the green shirt and the mask. What disease is the leading killer in the U.S.? Killer. Well, actually, it's what results from diabetes cases, and that is heart disease. Heart disease is a leading killer. It was the leading killer 40 years ago as well, but there's been a dramatic decline in heart disease as a result of public health. From 1969 to this point, heart disease has declined by 68%. Heart disease deaths have declined by 68%. A related problem, killer, leading killer, the number three cause of death throughout many of the last 30 years, it was stroke. It's declined by 77%. And I point out the year 1969 as the sort of baseline point for the progress that's been made, because in 1969, one of my medical school professors said, you know, chronic disease is just an inevitable consequence of the aging process. It just happens. There's nothing you can do about it except treat it. Things have changed, and things have changed as a result of the contributions and leadership of health. Okay, so question number two. One of the reasons that heart disease has declined is because of a reduction in tobacco use. What was the smoking use rate among men in the 1960s? Tobacco use? Okay, I'm going to call on somebody again. This nice lady right here with the beige sweat. Yes. Yes, they're all guesses. There's no wrong answer. Well, you're in the ballpark at 60%. It was a little over 60% in the 60s among men. Of course, it was much less among women then, an average of about 45%. Today, the tobacco use rate is now around 18% among adults as a whole. Really a dramatic change. When you think about it, and it's made a major contribution, including the contribution to reducing heart disease through public health, only through public health. Let's go to another issue, infant mortality. What is the infant mortality rate today? Okay, this nice lady with hat and bag. and I want to point out to everyone, it does not say MAGA on it. Wild guess, infant mortality rate today. 13. Fortunately, we've gone better than that. It's around 5.5. In fact, it was 13 when a report, or just a little less than that, when a report I'm going to talk about in a bit, Healthy People, was issued, with a target of reducing the infant mortality rate by 35% over the decade of 1980 to 1990. And actually, that target was reached. Today, the infant mortality rate is around 5.5. What do you think it was in 1960, the infant mortality rate? Four? 1960. No, it was actually 26 in 1960. So the infant mortality rate is not increasing. It's continuing to decrease, and it's decreased rather dramatically through public health, through better creating better conditions for women who are pregnant and their families. Of course, the shame is that that hasn't been a set of conditions that has been equally distributed. So the infant mortality rate for Black babies is still twice that of whites. But it's an important success rate overall. And for all ethnic populations, just not all equally. Let's move to infectious diseases, because we often think of public health essentially around infectious diseases, and ask the question, not about childhood infectious diseases like polio and so forth, because we know how much public health has clearly made an impact on those dimensions. But let's take a look at infectious diseases among adults and talk a little bit about what's happened with AIDS, HIV and AIDS. When AIDS was identified when was AIDS identified? What? 1981, actually. The Hamilton theme? I was in the room. You want to be in the room? I was in the room when Bill Foege from CDC, who was the director of CDC, was at an agency head meeting of all the public health service agencies, NIH, CDC, FDA, and so forth, and the Assistant Secretary for Health. And he was telling us about this curious little cluster of seven cases of Kaposi sarcoma and pneumocystis carinii. This was in June of 1981. And we sat around the table, you know, about 10 of us, trying to speculate on what could this be? And the interesting thing to me was how much time we devoted to that conversation because of the seven cases. But there were a few clues here and there. We decided that, you know, maybe a leading potential cause was amyl nitrate, because it was amyl nitrate inhalants that were used among the gay population in LA at that time. But obviously, from that point in June of 1981 to its peak, when do you think its peak was? Late 80s? 1995 was the peak at 50,000. It skyrocketed, and of course, its impact on the world became really the major challenge to many countries in the world. I mentioned this actually as a bit of a success story, because in a relatively short period of time, from the time that AIDS was identified in 1981-82 to 95 when it hit its peak, essentially public health kicked in. It kicked in by, one, detecting a disease, two, identifying the risk factors involved, three, identifying the mode of transmission, four, identifying the organism, five, developing a test for that organism. This was all done in a 3-year period, basically, unprecedented for that, for historically for that time. And then not too long thereafter, 1996, the treatments were developed, actually a major contribution here at Columbia. It's a very important success story, largely for public health. Of course, the treatment has been a miracle in helping to stabilize the situation around the world. But its public health has started off in the right direction. There's a little bit of a different story in terms of a rocky start, although given the times it was compressed, with another infectious disease, the one we're just still contending with, but have come through, COVID-19. How many deaths do you think there have been from COVID-19 in the US between January of 2020 and January of 2023? Okay, yes. Boy, you're right on the mark. You're Googling right away. No, very good. It's about 1.2 million, but it's under that, 1.1x. That's the number of deaths that occurred in this country over that 3-year period. It's obviously a huge amount. There is a good news and a bad news to the story. The good news, again, in terms of public health kicking in, was that we were able to develop, because of earlier work, a way of detecting and identifying the virus, and then developing a test for it. But the bad news story is that, you know, in my back of the envelope computations, about a third of the people, of those 1.1 million people who died, didn't need to die if we just followed the basic principles of public health that you all know and that we had used before. Detect the problem, isolate the infection, the affected case until you can identify what it is, identify the mode of transmission and the risk group, identify the agent at hand, develop a test for it, and then develop identify what the prevalence is around the world. And the public health response was impaired. Even though we had the basic science capacity to move much more swiftly, and politics was a major impediment. Hundreds of thousands of people lost their lives that didn't need to, just in this country. Again, a lesson, a sort of a harbinger of the conversation we're going to have a little later, and that your dean mentioned about the role of politics in public health. I see my clock is ticking, so I better move right along because I've got 30 slides to show you. but I can go through them very quickly. I'm not going to query you anymore because you definitely know all these answers, like the fact that life expectancy has actually decreased in the last 2 years. And there's a 7-year gap between life expectancy for whites and life expectancy for blacks. And that the suicide rates have also increased by about 50% for both young people and older people. The important element from a public health perspective is the trend for young people, in which it's actually started to come down as a result of public health interventions over the last 2 or 3 years. But it's especially important to note this, not so much as a failure or a success, but as a reality, a problem of increased mental health challenges throughout society. And we don't have a very strong idea about how to contend with that or its sources. So that's a peg to come back to in your work. So heart disease, tobacco, infant mortality, HIV, COVID, tremendous public health victories embedded in there. Of course, when we think about where we are now with respect to movement into the future with an even more complex, politically supercharged, economically challenging future, we need many, many more public health workers to be leading the cause. It's only through public health that we're going to be able to make the kinds of gains that are possible. So what I'm going to do now is take you through those 30 slides, but very quickly, just to give you a sense of the evolution of the trends and the factors involved in public health approaches, that factors that are still in play that need to be engaged, plus a number of others. Here's the definition of public health straight from CDC, the science of protecting and improving the health of people in their communities, second nature to you, 1970s. In the 1970s, public health was undergoing a change because of the passage of Medicare and Medicaid and the increased resources devoted to treatment. And that began to shift attention away from public health as a fundamental tool. And in fact, public health departments began to move more into that capacity. So the model standards for community public health services that were released 1976 were very broad. Assessment, assurance here was making sure that people were connected with the care that they needed. Policy development. It was a little bit of ambivalence with the public health community about where the stake should be planted most strongly. And prevention, frankly, with that bolus of dollars. I should say not bolus, it was really more like a tidal wave, relatively, began to have its focus diffused a little bit. And I'm not saying that's a bad thing, I'm just saying it's what happened. And prevention was viewed as a little more nebulous than treating somebody who had an acute injury or illness right in front of you and having dollars to be able to support that. So in with the Carter administration, under the leadership of Julius Richmond, who was the Surgeon General, we tried to rebalance the situation and give a little more specificity to what prevention, otherwise a nebulous notion, was, by noting that in fact, it was three fundamentally important activities: health promotion, that is, working on issues and behavioral choices that were driving 40% of the deaths that were occurring at that time; health protection, environmental, occupational, and so forth; and clinical preventive services, which you may recall were not part of the Medicare and Medicaid legislation from 1965. So the Healthy People effort was an attempt to try to rebalance this and actually to set goals and the kind of improvement that could be achieved. Let's move to the 1980s. In the 1980s, there was an increased effort in the public health arena to try to bear down on the possibilities, to try to engage that issue that preventive services weren't part of the health financing enterprise. In fact, I recall very specifically a conversation that I had with the head of then the Healthcare Financing Administration, that today's CMS, when I, as the policy focus in the department, sent over a request to reimburse for clinical preventive services and had a list of those and for the older population and the younger population, and indicated that the science base for this was very strong, stronger, in fact, than many of the treatment services that were being covered. And I got back a response from the HICFA actuary, which said, in effect, we can't justify this proposal because you can't tell us that or prove to us that it wouldn't be cheaper just to go ahead and treat people who got ill from not having the preventive services. Furthermore, you can't guarantee certainly that they wouldn't draw down on Medicare funds because they live longer, or Social Security funds for that matter, if you can believe that. So I picked up the phone and called her, that person, and said, I have tomorrow's New York Times headlines right here in my hand. But because of that, really atrocious response, we formed the U.S. Preventive Services Task Force to mobilize all of that evidence, to make it undeniable and irresistible to provide reimbursement for purposes. And in addition, in the IOM, I wasn't in the IOM then, but a fundamentally landmark report was issued in 1988 on the future of public health, which emphasized the fact that prevention in public health was losing the public's attention in terms of the potential impact on the health of the public and the fundamental dependence of the health of the public on public health. And it is underscored opportunities as well as challenges in that respect. Let's move to the 1990s, or not. There we go. And the 1990s, I'm going to point out just one activity there, and that is the Clinton reform debate. You may recall that Hillary Rodham Clinton was put by the president in charge of the healthcare reform effort. Now, there were a couple of things that we did, I say we from inside the department, to try to prepare for that. One was to develop a report on cost effectiveness in health and medicine to underscore the fact that this was a parallel report to the U.S. Preventive Services Task Force, because actually we had told them that they could not deal with economics involved. They needed to deal purely with the science. So we did a separate effort to focus on cost effectiveness to underscore the fact that preventive interventions were much more established as cost effective than the many of the treatment interventions that that were being paid for. The aim was to set the stage, and we actually talked about this at some level, including a proposal within the health reform package that would set aside a small percentage of all the federal treatment funds going to a particular area to devote to special opportunities within the jurisdiction that related to public health and prevention. And we had a complicated set of proposals that might to implement that, but it was before its time, really. It's a very complicated notion, but the fact is that the government, the administration was thinking about that sort of thing at that point in time. What did grow out of the healthcare reform activities was the 10 essential services of public health. I joined with health commissioners in all 50 states, having a series of town hall meetings in each of the states, under the supervision and guidance of a national steering committee made up of the public health service, the heads of CDC and NIH, the head of ASTO, the head of NACHO, the head of the APHA, and through the 50-state enterprise, if you will, the 10 essential services of public health were developed in order to be as specific as we could, to move beyond just the notion assurance and policy development, and to focus on monitoring, diagnosing, informing, mobilizing, developing, enforcing laws, linking people to personal services, assuring competent and public and personal healthcare workforce, evaluate effectiveness, and research for new insights. I'm not going to go through those again. They're second nature to you, and they'll be in my slides anyway if you need them later on. Those 10 essential services were taken by CDC, and they developed a graphic that linked them to assurance assessment and policy development, and began to develop specific strategies around each of them. The hope was that this could help inform both the educational process in schools of public health and the funding process throughout communities around the nation. The 2000s, to come to that quickly, part of the, actually, I'm going to then indicate the passage in 2009, the Affordable Care Act, which was a critical development, and the inclusion of preventive services in that act, including a variation on the theme of a set aside for preventive services, not necessarily pegged to the amount of money that was directly going into a community, but the development of prevention and public health trust fund, the elimination of preventive services cost sharing, the mandated coverage of preventive services, as well as population health-based financing demonstrations, the sort of thing that would give us a more practical approach to the concept that had earlier been discussed. And in addition, grants and incentives for prevention and wellness programs. 2010s, vital signs, I'm not going to go into this in detail, except to note that one of the biggest problems that was helping to further fragment and diffuse attention on the really important issues was the proliferation of thousands of measures that had to be reported that were an incredible burden on clinicians and a variety of other players, and were also diffusing focus. So the vital signs report by the Institute of Medicine tried to pull back and say, listen, we can develop 15 measure sets that focus on healthy people, care quality, care cost, engaged people, and develop composite measures that will substantially reduce the need and the burden across the board. We're still working on that. And I think that there, with artificial intelligence, there's at least the potential to begin to develop approximations that will obviate the need for as many measures as are currently required. Also growing out of that is an accountable health community initiative from CMMI to try to focus financing on important issues that lie outside the clinic doors. And then there was also the call for Public Health 3.0 from the administration, the Obama administration, under Karen DeSalvo's leadership, in which, in addition to 1.0, which was growth in knowledge and tools for public health and the problem of uneven access, and 2.0, which is the governmental capacity in public health and traditional function, to emphasize the need for actors and community partners involved and focus on social determinants. So let me just see here. I'm going to, I think, just sort of skip to the chase. You will hear more about the learning health system core principles, which have taken the quality chasm set of core principles and expanded them. And we're about to launch a major effort in that respect, adding transparency, measurability, security, and adaptivity to fundamental elements available and focused throughout the health system at large. Here they are in a little bookmark form. And coming to where we are now, and with a preview of the future, we were well positioned at the outset of COVID-19 to understand the impact on various sectors. And so we developed a leader-focused activity to look at the impact on 9 different sectors. And the bottom line is, across those 9 sectors, there were obviously individual impacts that were identified, but there were 3 that cut across all 9 sectors and prevented barriers to progress in all 9 sectors. Systemic fragmentation, perverse incentives, and structural inequities. And so, because of those challenges, we have set identified certain imperatives, that is, getting outside the clinic doors, not to forget what's inside, but to improve the linkages, aligning forces with fragmentation as the fundamental issue. Part of the strategy around the learning health system core principles is to align forces around some common denominators. Financing focused on results, and this is obviously the critical one when all is said and done. It's about the money. And we're not going to achieve reduced fragmentation. We're not going to achieve the kind of equity progress that can be made without changing the way the money flows. And so we have developed a commission that on investment imperatives for a healthy nation. I could spend another hour on this, but I'm not. I'm going to give you just 1 minute to say that there are 5 work streams individual and community health goals as a central focus, inclusive, equitable systems as national values, data and digital architecture, funding and accountability, and private equity health investments. We need to know the impact of those private equity investments are. Those work streams are active now. The commission will be focusing on taking those work stream results and developing recommendations around incentives and alignment opportunities and workforce needs. I'm going to leave it at that. We can come back and talk more later on it if it seems appropriate. What you don't see here, you don't see public health. You don't see healthcare. You don't see Alzheimer's or heart disease. And the reason is that these are fundamental infrastructure issues that have to be front and center. The changes have to be front and center if we're going to achieve what's possible. This is a report that we did about 3 years ago, AI and Healthcare, the Hike, the Hope, the Promise, and the Peril. The fact is that what we've seen in the last year with generative AI and large language models does have the potential to be a game changer on behalf of the democratization of health, on behalf of the acceleration of progress. And I won't say anything else on that because we don't really know exactly how much a difference it's going to make yet. So 2030s here, that's where we are now, or looking toward. Obviously the big ticket items are going to be the impact of climate change. You can't deal with these issues without a public health infrastructure being stronger than ever. Public health 4.0. Dean Fried's contribution with colleagues, growing from the various dimensions of work, but the notion is very real that we're going to have a tsunami of older people are going to present previously unrecognized challenges. And so whatever system we develop has to take advantage of the technology, has to take advantage of the overwhelming challenges as we develop strategies. And focus in these areas in particular, individual and community goals, for understanding and acting on those goals. Population health is a strategic partnering of healthcare, public health, social services, and those served. That means not only partnering for activities, but sharing funding streams. Technology is a democratizing facilitator of this focus. I mentioned that briefly. System-wide transparency is an essential value. We can accomplish a great deal if we just had more transparency. The demand function is something that needs to be cultivated. The demand function among the population, we're not going to cultivate that demand function without greater transparency from top to bottom throughout the system. Health budgeting and payments oriented to results. Alignment, I've already talked about that, alignment of federal incentives, not just CMS, but FTC and SEC to accommodate those private equity investments that are distorting the playing field. AI-based performance assessment and accountability, and public health as the core navigator and steward of the progress. It is the trusted agent, and we have to position it in that respect. Thank you all very much. I'm sorry we went a little longer, but appreciate that.
Great. Thank you very much for the overview of some of the accomplishments of public health, for the incredibly fast but amazing overview of the last 50 years of what's happened in public health with those slides, and for all that you've done over the years in public health. You've really, as you said, been in the room when so much has happened in such a good way. So I want to start by thanking you. So I'm going to start, I've been thinking a little bit along with Dean Fried and Mike, et cetera, about the role of health in a transforming health system and improving health equity, et cetera. And the immediate concern that I have, and that I think we have to sort of think about and talk about, is that the public health system, you know, the public health workforce that we have, the government public health workforce that we have here in the United States today, is under-resourced, it's underpaid, it's undervalued. In the last half a dozen years, we've lost nearly half of our public health workforce in this country, and that exit is accelerating rather than diminishing. And so that's a major issue. Before we can actually think, I think, really effectively about how public health, and at least the public health, the core public health workforce, can help with the transformation of the health system and improve equity, but I think we have to think about how to rebuild the public health sector itself. The federal government recognized that, as Mike said, during COVID, and they said, all right, we're going to start by allocating $8 billion, or 7.66 to be exact, but nearly $8 billion to try to rebuild the public health workforce, to try, as Mike said, to add 100,000 new public health workers to the United States. So Larry Brown, sitting over there, and myself, got a grant to see, well, how's that playing out? How's that playing out? What's working, what's not working, et cetera? And what we did was we picked five states, Indiana, Kentucky, Mississippi, New York, and Washington State. And we said, let's go to those states and let's sort of see how the money is going from DC to the capital of the state, to the local health departments, to the grassroots. So what I want to do first is take a few minutes to talk about what we found, and then I'm going to talk about a half dozen ideas or so that at least occur to me as to how we should think about rebuilding the public health system. So what did we find? Well, the first thing we found, well, I should say what we were looking at in particular. Well, it's an $8 billion program. The first tranche of money, which is what we were really looking at, was the first $2 billion. The first $2 billion that was sent out to all 50 states, plus a number of large local health departments, plus some tribal health departments, and some territorial health departments. So state, local, territorial, and tribal. So first thing we found was that no state spent all the money they had, despite all of the shortfalls in public health workforce. No state has yet spent all the money. They had from July 1st of 21 to June 30th of 23 to spend the money. They haven't spent the money, not one of them. They've all applied for no-cost extensions, saying, okay, federal government, we have more time, more time, more time. We haven't spent the money. So why? Why haven't they spent the money? Why haven't they hired any people as they hope? Well, let me give you three reasons why they haven't spent the money. Forget the number one. First of all, as I just said, the money was for July 1, 21 to June 30, 23. So it was time limited and it was siloed. You had to spend the money, unless you got an extension, in that two-year period. And the workers you hired had to work on COVID and COVID alone. They couldn't work on opioids. They couldn't work on obesity. They couldn't work on gun violence. This was just for COVID. And you know what? Hiring someone, as the months go by, you're talking about hiring them. Well, now it's maybe 2 years, but then it takes a few months to figure out what you want to do. And it's 18 months, it's 16 months, it's 14 months. Now you're talking about hiring someone for 12 months on a 12-month contract because the money's going to run out. So the time-limited, siloed nature of the problem, that was number one. Number two, civil service rules, bureaucratic rules, hiring rules. I didn't know this before we started. Maybe some of you know this, but I'll give you one example. The New York State Health Department, over half of the people who work in theory for the New York State Public Health Department or at the New York State Department of Health in the public health unit, over half of them actually don't get their paycheck from New York State because they, you know, New York State couldn't hire them because of civil service rules. So they're all hired by a nonprofit called HRI or here in New York City, a nonprofit called Public Health Solutions or whatever. And then they're embedded. And you know what? The courts have held that that's illegal. And the courts have ordered the state in order to phase that out. And yet that rule is still in effect right now. It's been extended because of COVID. The city and the state's gotten extra time. But it's a catastrophe in the making. And it's a problem not just in New York, it's around the country. That's the second reason. Third reason is you're talking about jobs that are low pay and low prestige. You know, so you're basically asking people to take 14-month jobs getting around civil service rules often, you know, for less money than they could get working in a hospital, a managed care organization, a consulting firm, et cetera. All right, so the states haven't spent all the money and all these problems exist. They've hired people. I don't want to say it's been a waste of money. People say, well, they wasted the money. No, they haven't wasted the money. They're doing things with the money. They're hiring people. People are doing good things, but it's going really slowly. And the, I mean, I'll give you one, just one example. Albany County, so much, there've been so many disputes between New York State, for example, and the counties how to spend this money. Albany County took 25% of the money that they were offered by New York State to hire new workers. And they rejected the other 75%, even though they've got incredible shortfalls of public health workers. Long story, I don't want to get into right now why the big battle there, but the bottom line is the implementation of this program hasn't gone nearly as well as it could have. That's point one. Point number two, there are, one thing we found, interestingly and importantly, there are states that have come up with really creative ways to increase state funding. I mean, the federal funding is all done through the CDC on this project, but to increase state funding for their public health workforce. And they're actually implementing some of those programs pretty well. So I mentioned one of them, that's the state of Indiana. The state of Indiana ranked 48th in the country prior to COVID in what the state contributed to the public health workforce in that state. It's kind of a disaster. State's a Republican state, it's a conservative state, it has a conservative Republican governor, a guy named Eric Holcomb, conservative state legislature. Holcomb became convinced during COVID that they had to do more. And Indiana is a poor state. It's not a poor state. I mean, it's the sports capital. It's the sports capital of the United States. It's got a lot of money. It's got Eli Lilly. It has a lot of big companies in it. It has a lot of tax revenue. So they say, I mean, it was a problem of politics, not allocation. So Holcomb says, all right, we want to figure out a way to spend more money on public health. They came up with a strategy that, three parts to their strategy. Number one, they said, you know what? The key for us is we have to convince the local elected officials, the local mayors, the local city council people, the local county commissioners, that this is a good use of money. This was during COVID, partisanship running rampant. A lot of these local political leaders were saying, we don't want mandates around masks, around vaccines, relatively low rates in Indiana of vaccine take up, et cetera, et cetera. So they figured, you know, the state said, you know, we have to figure out a way to convince these local elected officials that this is a good idea. Because if we don't get the mayors, I mean, we spoke, Larry and I got to speak with the person who really engineered, I would say, you know, there were two, what Holcomb did was he brought in two co-chairs to run this commission for them that was going to create this legislation. One was a woman named Judy Monroe, CEO of the CDC Foundation, former health commissioner in Indiana, really ingrained, powerful, terrific person. You know, the other, though, was a guy named Luke Kenley, conservative Republican, former state legislator in charge of the budget committee for many years in the legislature, not a friend of public health, but he became a friend of public health as he became learned more and more and more. And he basically was able to work with the local elected officials. He said the single most important thing that they did politically was they got the mayors, the city council people, and the county commissioners to support the proposed legislation. How did they get them to do that? They worked with them, they traveled the state, they talked to them. And they also said, you know what, the money, the new money is not gonna go to the state health department. It's gonna go directly to the local counties that you work in. You're gonna get the money. You're going to have a lot of flexibility in how you spend the money, but basically you have to spend, there are going to be some strings, but you have to spend the money, interestingly enough, on things that you might consider to be relatively non-controversial, on vital records, on restaurant inspections, on water and sewage inspections, et cetera. You know, it was like spend the money on the things, this money on the things that are not all that controversial, and that'll free up local state dollars. So if you want to have an opioid, you know, initiative, if you want to have an initiative around gun violence, if you want to have an initiative around isolated elderly and lonely elderly, you know, you'll have dollars for that, but this money is going to free up money for that. And third thing is the local counties, you have to opt in. You know, you have to opt in. We're not mandating this. This is not a state mandate. It actually worked. And that Indiana model has become a national model in a lot of respects. And there's people all over the country calling up Luke Kenley and calling up Judy Monroe and saying, how exactly did Indiana pull this off? All right, so what do I take away from this? You know, this study that we did in this thing. And I'm just thinking about it. I'm just thinking about it now and working with Larry, working with Dean Freed, et cetera. And let me give you six ideas that sort of pop into my head. And maybe we could sort of talk about some of them. Some of them I think people in the room might agree with. Some of them I think the public health community more generally might have trouble with. Sort of idea number one, and Mike talked about this, public health is incredibly underfunded right now. And it's been underfunded for a long time. And most of the people who are talking about giving more money to public health right now, what they're saying is let's give more money to the CDC. Let's increase the CDC budget because the CDC takes most of its budget and it passes it along to state and local health departments. Seems to me we need a new model for public health funding and financing. And I would throw out one idea is like the Medicaid model or the CHIP model. Basically have the money not go to the CDC, money go to the states directly. But the states have to contribute as well to get the money. I mean, the way CHIP works, the way Medicaid works, is the feds pay, depending on the state, between 50 and 78% of the cost. The state has to pay the rest. But there are strings attached. I think actually, unless you come up with a new model of financing, you're not going to really solve the problem of financing and sort of the ability of these local public health and state health departments to effectively do what they need to do. So number one, I think you need a new financing model. Number two, I think we have to dramatically rethink public civil service and bureaucratic rules around hiring in this country. I mean, civil service plays an important role in protecting workers. And I've, for a long time, been a big fan of civil service and the way it's sort of the idea of it, you know, merit-based jobs and protection, et cetera. But I think civil service rules have become an obstacle to hiring the workforce that we need here in the United States. They become a real obstacle. Third thing, and I've sort of written about this a little bit and talked about it, I do think we need sort of from a political perspective, sort of clearer leadership for public health at the very top, at the national level. And so, I mean, I've argued for a while, I don't think it's gonna happen anytime soon, but I've argued for a while, we should have a secretary of public health in the president's cabinet. You know, the reason we have a surgeon general, we have this, we have that, but they're all buried to a certain extent, you know, within, you know, a Department of Health and Human Services that is primarily focused on Medicaid, on Medicare, you know, on health insurance. I actually think there needs to be a cabinet position for public health to give it more visibility. That's number three. At the same time, number four, I think we have to spend a lot more time thinking about local elected officials. We have almost 3,000, we have 2,600, 2,700, I mean, the numbers vary a little bit. We have almost 3,000 local, state, tribal, and territorial health departments in this country. And they are the heart and soul of the public health system in the United States. I mean, they are the core of the public health system in the United States. And they are in trouble. They are in trouble, and they're also not looked to. I mean, I've had conversations with healthcare leaders here in New York City. And I've said to them, how are you addressing the social determinants of health here in New York City? And they've said to me, oh, we contract with all these social services agencies. We need the social services agencies. And so I said, well, what about the New York City Department of Health? Oh, we don't really do anything with them. You know, we get some data from them. They regulate us a little bit. But you've got the medical care pipeline. You've got the social services pipeline. And then you have the public health pipeline. And the public health pipeline is essentially the stepchild, really, of those other two, not only the medical care system, but even the social services system in a lot of ways, even though we talk about all the things that public health should be engaged in and involved in. And I actually think the key to getting those 2,500 local health departments some more power really is about local elected officials. We have to convince in a decentralized, fragmented system, public health system like we have in the United States, where constitutionally power is vested in these local health departments, whether it should be or not. I mean, we could, you know, that's where it is. We have to convince local officials that public health is just as important to them as the police, as the fire people, as all the other public health public services they get. That's number four. Number five, and this one, I don't know, this one might be where it's a little contrary to at least where public health has been going. You know, when we were in Mississippi, when Larry and I were in Mississippi, we saw firsthand how the 86 local health departments in Mississippi provide primary care services. And they get in Mississippi about 50% of their revenue, those local health departments, from Medicaid. And they use that money to do other things. Now, that used to be the case. That's still the case in some other places around the country. But it used to be the case in most, I mean, when I worked for New York City many, many years ago, and New York City used to actually get a lot of money from Medicaid, its health departments, for providing, you know, preventive and primary and clinical services one to another. But the public health community writ large sort of has the view and had the view that, you know what, that's focusing, let other people worry about individual health care. You know, our job is to think about the health of the population writ large. You know, let the community health centers, let the this, let the that take care of the primary care. We don't want, that diverts us. You know, it diverts us from our mission. And so there's been a movement away in the public health community from providing primary care, direct primary care services or clinical services of sort. And I get that. I get the reasons why. I mean, there's been a major movement away from that. But number one, that's had a very significant adverse financial impact on many local health departments. Number two, I think you could make an argument, and this was the way local health departments sort of, you know, how they validated what they were doing was they said it was part of the assurance tool. You know, they had to assure that services were being provided, and if they weren't provided by anyone else, maybe the local health departments could do it. I get that there's issues with, you know, spreading yourself too thin, and we want to focus on the population, et cetera. But, you know, one of the ways that you help the population is by making sure individuals have the kind of services, primary care services and immunizations and all those things that they need. And I actually think we should reconsider whether or not public health should re-engage with that for a variety of reasons. And I think it's potentially a way also of re-engaging and becoming a bigger player in healthcare. And I have to tell you, there's a big debate in the United States right now about who's going to provide primary care services around the country. And we've got CVS, and we've got Walmart, and we have Rite Aid, and we have Dollar General, and we have Best Buy, all saying we're going to be the ones in the future that are going to provide primary care services because we're the general store of the 21st century. CVS has over 1,000 minute clinics right now providing primary care service. There are 2,800 local health departments. I think arguably those local health departments should be taking that role instead of CVS, but we'll have to see. We'll have to see how that plays out. A last comment, I'm out of time here now myself too, in terms of number six, I just think we have to have much more of a focus, and we talk about it, but much more of a focus on implementation. You know, I think the American Rescue Plan allocating $8 billion to state and local agencies was a good thing. It's a good thing. But, you know, a political scientist many years ago, Michael Lipsky, wrote a book called Street Level Bureaucrats. It's a great book, great idea. I mean, the notion is you got to think about who's providing services on the ground and what's happening when the money leaves Washington, D.C. and makes its way all the way to public health workers or to community health workers or what a nurse, public health nurses or epidemiologists. What are their obstacles? And why is it that here in New York State, for example, you know, the local health departments pretty much hate the state health department officials. The state health department officials pretty much can't stand the federal officials. And the federal officials think they're all incompetent at the state and local level. You know, I mean, there's a lot of tension that we've heard between these different levels of government. And it affects how programs are implemented. And it affects the way the public health system that we have. And so it seems to me, sort of bottom line, if we want to think about how public health can be a force in transforming the health system in the United States and how public health can be a force in increasing health equity, the first thing we have to do is think about how to rebuild and strengthen and stabilize the public health system and make it a player in all of these areas. That does mean we have to think about the interest group politics. We have to think about the cultural and ideological politics. We have to think about the institutional setting. And we have to think about the implementation, all of those things. Public health is never going to be able to do it on its own. That's clear. But public health, you know, even with even with the role it has right now, it needs to, I mean, what's the, you know, what do they say when you're on the airplane and, you know, they say about the masks coming down, you know, put your own mask on first and then save the person next to you. Well, to a certain extent, I think public health needs to put its mask on and really try to think of some innovative ways to save itself, because I think it's at risk of the public health system, the government public health system in the United States, I think is at risk of collapsing in many respects. And we can't have that. And so I think we need to think about innovative, maybe out of the box or alternative ideas as to public health and how to strengthen public health. So let me stop there. Thanks.
Thank you. Oops. Thank you to both of our Michaels, Dr. McGinnis and Dr. Spear, for really fabulous presentations. I'm going to just ask a question or two, and then I'd like to turn it over to the audience for your questions. But I want to start to Michael McGinnis. You know, we have this situation where 70% of a population's health comes from public health. We know that. We have a situation where we've taken a bunch of detours over the last 40 years. For example, the long detour of thinking that it was just a matter of individual willpower to engage in health behaviors that were salutary. A lot of public health science went down that road for a while, but we've relearned that in fact most of a population's health is shaped by its exposome, by the ability to deliver the conditions in which people can be healthy. We've learned that our overinvestment that you said in medical care has had, and the kind of medical care has had very serious consequences. So the U.S.'s health status is now at the bottom of peer nations, and we spend more than any other nation in getting there. And the missing element that you both have said is adequate public health. At the same time, we've had signal accomplishments. They all the accomplishments, to my mind, Michael, that you listed add up to the fact that we've added 30 years to human life expectancy in the last 100 years, and 25 of those 30 years came from public health. That's astounding. But we have many more challenges that we have to accomplish that only public health can do. And so, and putting the public health investments, I'm going to challenge you, Michael Sperrer, into medical care delivery when the disinvestment has been in prevention at the population side, which is where the action is, as Michael McGinnis said. Wouldn't that put us back in the same place we were starting in the 1960s or 70s of pouring money into treatment and really under investing by miles in the population conditions that enable health and health equity? So I don't know if you can respond. Yeah.
I mean, I think I'm still on. I think I'm still mic'd up. I mean, I don't, you know, I completely understand why the public health community decided a number of years ago, to the extent it could, to move away from providing primary care services, clinical services, et cetera. I don't think, and this is, you know, I don't think it's like a sure thing that making the switch is going to be the right thing. But I think, you know, I think there are tremendous gaps in primary care and prevention right now. Around the country that public health agencies and public health nurses could help fill and actually would help. I think it potentially in Mississippi, for one example, number one, the public health clinics are filling a tremendous need because they are assuring the health of the population of their community in different ways. I don't think, I mean, you could make an argument, well, does that mean they're missing out on a TB outbreak because they don't have the epidemiologists? They've just got too many nurses providing care. I think that's a concern. I think you have to build up the whole system, including the epidemiologists, including the environmental health people, including all of the other people who work for public health. So I don't think that this is the single answer. I do think it would pump more money into the system. I do think a program like Medicaid should be more than just about, I mean, Medicaid these days, for better or worse, rightly or wrongly, I actually think it's for better, but it's controversial. Medicaid these days is spending all of its energy talking about the social determinants of health and how we should be using the dollars of Medicaid to improve and address the social determinants. Hospitals are talking about social determinants of health. Where are they getting the money to do that? They're getting that from Medicaid programs. So I think Medicaid and public health should be working together much more closely. And so I think this division that really started between the public health system and the health insurance system is not the division that we necessarily need. I think the point you raise is an important one, and I think we have to be cautious. I remember in Seattle a number of years ago, the health commissioner of King County, Seattle, you know, was concerned that they had missed a TB outbreak. That's what made me think of it, because they were devoting too much of their time, he thought, to sort of providing individual services and not enough time to sort of checking out what was happening with the community. So I think it's a risk, but I also think if you can fundamentally change the way public health is funded, if you move more towards a CHIP type model or some other model where you're pumping more money into it, that risk is lessened. But I'd be curious as to what you think on that too, Mike.
I think that we're in a different time in many ways. We're in a different time because we fully understand, as we had no clue 30 years ago, basically, about the factors that impinge on health that are outside the clinic doors. We're at a very different time in that we, as a society, at least have a sense of the perversity of fee-for-service, although we haven't been able to act on it. So I personally don't have reservations about the notion of public health and healthcare becoming more aligned, including the possibility of public health providing services, but only, at least in my view, if the financing scheme is very different. If in fact the way that the funds flow is to focus on overall health outcomes, so that fee-for-service does not become the same sucking sound in the public health community as it does in the medical Absolutely. Care community. Absolutely. So unless and until that shift can occur, I would be resistant. But I think we need to, as a society, focus very clearly on moving as fast as we can away from fee-for-service. But just say one more thing. I like your proposal for, I like a number of the things that you said, which were, I thought, right on point. But for the notion of shared federal cost for public health, like the Medicaid program, in fact, if it were to me and I only had two choices, I would choose to have the cost sharing for public health and not for Medicaid. Have the federal government pick that one up, right? Because that's where the incentives are needed.
So please, I'd like to invite, we can take a couple of questions from our wonderful audience, and please raise your hand and somebody will bring a mic over to you, I think, or I will. Oh, yeah. And while the hands are going up, I'll just say that, you know, across the two of you, both Michaels here, you made compelling cases for the role of government in leading public health, which I think is very important to remember. Michael, you said that public health has to be understood as a public service as much as having a police force or parks or whatever the essential public goods are that make a thriving society. But like any park that doesn't get kept up, if you don't make the adequate investments in the delivery of the conditions to the population in which people that enable people to be healthy, you have the public health analogy of a rundown park. And yes. Oh, good. Somebody has a mic.
Sorry.
Please stand up and introduce yourself.
Hi. Sorry, Megan Spinella. I'm a public health student here. Quick question. How do you think we go about, I guess, you were saying that public health jobs in the local sector, specifically at these local centers, aren't very glamorous. People are kind of going to the private sector or they're going to other places. How do we go about making these jobs more desirable? Is it just give them more money? Or are there other things that we can do to, I guess, attract young talent away from big consulting firms and towards local health centers?
Well, you have asked the 64,000, the 64 million, the $64 billion question. You've asked exactly the question. You know, I mean, the majority of graduates of the Mailman School of Public Health don't go to work for the government public health system. You know, and there are reasons for that. How we address that, I do think civil service, I'll give you one example. Here in New York City, the New York City Health Department, about half of the New York City Health Department workers work for the city, and about half work for the, you know, some of the nonprofits, and they're embedded. I was talking to some folks at various points during COVID. If you worked for Public Health Solutions, or if you worked for one of the nonprofits, but you were working for the city, you were allowed to work remotely. If you worked for the New York City Health Department, you had to come into the office. So you had two people who were sitting next to each other doing the same job, one employed by the city and one employed by a nonprofit. And the one employed by a nonprofit, you had more flexibility. You know, I mean, so it's just, we've got to figure out how to make government work. And this isn't just in public health. This is make government work, whether it's fire, you know, there's an anti-government sort of philosophy out there now, mm-hmm. which is one of the reasons that the ARP stayed all their money, because it's, you know, they had to get, I mean, if you're going to hire 100,000 new people, you got to get local political communities to create new jobs. And how you break that resistance down, I actually think starts by making the argument at the local level with local elected officials as to the importance of this. But I don't have a magic answer to that question.
Well, do you want to come?
No, I definitely do. I think you're right, quite right. And I love the question because it's at the heart of the matter. From my perspective, there are two or three things that need to happen. One is related to the bureaucracy. I worked in government, and even, you know, 40 years ago when I was in government, I was developing alternative hiring strategies. Didn't have to go through the HR hoops. I think we have to have a very different approach. It's essentially empowering people who are making the decisions to do their job and trusting them at some level. So the notion of reinventing the empowerment that's given to individuals is really key. And I actually think there's hope there. Again, I'm a glass half full guy, no question about it. But I've seen some of what generative AI can do in terms of democratizing the decision-making power and empowering people. And I think that there are which the level playing field will help us move away from the hierarchical dimensions that are paralyzing us in several arenas. So I think that's really key. Well, the other issue that's important from my perspective is stories. I mean, the work that you do makes a difference. It makes a big difference in so many ways. And I think that that really needs to be told. And it needs to be a fun to come back to the point about local folks. It needs to be a fundamental part of the tool chest of every mayor in the country. And if I mentioned this commission that we're doing on investment imperatives, what I didn't mention is that part of our strategy is to develop a philanthropic coalition, philanthropy at the local level. And so we're developing a coalition of local funders in order to put pressure at the local level to have them work with their mayors and their other local leaders in order to build the democratic power from the bottom up.
I couldn't agree more with you. I just want to add two things real quick. And I know we are running out of time. But one is, I don't want to give the wrong impression. I think I could speak for Larry and myself to say, I was unbelievably impressed with the people we met who are working in local and state health departments around this country for relatively low money, for relatively low prestige, et cetera, working 17, 18 hours a day, really trying to protect against COVID, but also do their jobs. I mean, an incredibly committed, impassioned, motivated, terrific group of people. The other thing I would say is they should have pipelines. You know, there need to be more pipelines for advancement within a lot of these local health departments as to what's your next job going to be after you've done X, and how do you get that next job? And I think we should be thinking about how we create sort of pipelines and training programs and strategies, you know, for where they go in 5 years or 10 years after they work for a local health agency for a while.
So I think we are out of time, and I apologize. We would love to keep this conversation going. I think that this is really about the theme of this grand rounds and what would it take? And I thank both Dr. McGinnis and Dr. Sparrow for leading us through a really critically important set of discussions. Thank you.